Have you had an encounter with the King of the Forest? Did you get a royal escort out of his kingdom? Or did you leave on your own? Well, whatever happened, I want to hear about it. And so does everyone else. So send me an email with all the details. You can send it to me at contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. Well, hello again, everyone. I'm glad to see you all gathered and ready for our journey tonight down into Sasquatch Valley. Now, both of our stops tonight on our journey are actually just next door to me in Indiana. One of our submitters we have heard from before. He's a retired law enforcement officer, and he has sent us some fabulous emails. But first, before we get to his story, we're going to make a stop in Jefferson County, Indiana, and we're going to hear of some strange goings-on happening there. So if you haven't already, go grab that snackage. Get your saddlebag loaded. There are some very clear tracks we're going to follow tonight. So look lively and keep your head on a swivel as we make the journey into the dark valley of Sasquatches. Are you ready? Let's go. Hi, Nance. I've been listening now for a few years. I like your channel, and I find your voice and the way you read these stories soothing. We've had things happening here for years, and honestly, I never associated it with anything but my very odd neighbor. And he, according to his son, thought we were up to something over here. He was a troubling sort of man. I'm pretty sure that now most of the mischief around here was from a juvenile Sasquatch and his family group or tribe or whatever the correct term may be. My first experience with Sasquatch, that I knew it was not my neighbor or anyone human, was when I was getting ready for a shooting event the next day. I was reloading ammunition on my back deck for 3 shooters. As this process went on, it got dark outside, but I had my lights on. I was just doing my thing when all of a sudden, this critter was behind my garage, making all kinds of noise, like breaking branches, and making sounds similar to the Velociraptor from Jurassic Park. Now, I used to hunt, and I was in the Army for 14 years in long-range reconnaissance and sniper, and I was a scout before that. So I'm very much at ease in the woods, and I'm familiar with most animals and the sounds they make. But this thing sounded big, and it made some crazy sounds. I instinctually felt like it was trying to run me off, but it never showed itself. I heard it pick up a mower deck back behind the garage and slam it into the ground. Let me tell you, that got my attention, because I've moved that deck myself, and it's not light, and nothing I know of in the woods of Jefferson County, Indiana, is capable of doing that. Then it repeatedly slammed it to the ground, over and over, while screaming, and it ended with tossing it many yards across my backyard. Wow. So the big boy wants me inside, was my thought. Now, I was open to the idea of Sasquatch, but I honestly thought that it was a Pacific Northwest kind of thing, if they existed. Never did I think that they would be in the Hoosier State. So I'm feeling a tad intimidated by this display of power and aggression. By normal standards, I'm a huge man. And during this time, I'm 120 pounds heavier than in my Army days. I'm 6 feet 5 inches and 350 pounds, and working hard to be a pro strongman at the time, and I was working in the automotive industry. So I go inside, and I grab a shotgun. I set it by my press, and I go back to work. It started these odd chattering noises then, and I'm not sure what it is yet, but I am thinking Bigfoot. So I yelled out, "Big boy, You're not running me inside. I do as I please on my own property. And though he was in the shadows, I knew his position. I fired a slug approximately 3 feet to its right to get the point across that I'm not going to be an easy person to bully. I had no idea of Bigfoot and their capabilities back then, but I was 100% confident in my abilities to wage war. After all, I was a tested warrior, a combat veteran, and a gunsmith with a particularly nasty Saiga 12 combat shotgun with 20 slugs in the drum. I was pretty good in my mind for anything. It did settle down, and I was done loading ammo for my chute. So I packed up my gear and went inside for the night with no other incidents. This was our first encounter with one other, and I wasn't sure yet what I was dealing with. But he sure knew me. They've been watching us for years. I've been sitting on these encounters as well for years. People don't believe you. I didn't believe when a friend told me that he had seen one in Clifty Falls State Park here in Jefferson County, Indiana. I thought he was just being silly. Thanks for letting us get this out. Signed, Big Eric. Nance, I was getting a haircut from a woman who lives down the road from us last week, and while making small talk, she related an incident that had her pretty spooked. I had asked her what was going on in her life, and she hesitated. Then she replied with the old, "You're going to think I'm crazy, but..." So I assured her that I wouldn't think anything like that, and I asked her to tell me what had happened. She told me that a few days ago, her dog was in her backyard, barking non-stop. She figured that he was barking at a squirrel, but she then noticed that he was growling while he barked. She decided that she had better see what was up, so she went outside. And this was in the daytime, by the way. She said that her dog was standing on the back deck, looking toward her small apple orchard, and he seemed fixated on something, and it was really upsetting him. She said that the ridge on his back was standing up, and his hair was seeming to stand on end. This is called piloerection, and it usually means that a dog is fearful or angered in some way. My dogs do this when they hear recorded Sasquatch howls. This is how I know a recording is genuine, as studio-created howls do not affect them. She went on to explain that she had kept trying to see what was angering the dog so much, but she couldn't see anything. She then hesitated again, and then told me that this is where things became frightening for her. She said that she looked intently at the spot that her dog was focused upon, and then she saw it. She said that she suddenly noticed a huge human-like form standing in the trees, but it wasn't solid. She said that the best way she could describe it was that it looked like she was looking through water. It was transparent, but it seemed to shimmer, and it distorted what was behind it. She said she yelled out, "I'm not afraid of you." She then grabbed her dog by the collar and took him back inside, even though the dog kept twisting around to look at the thing, and it continued to growl. She went and retrieved her pistol and looked out the window, but claimed that she could no longer see whatever it was. I asked her if that was it, and she replied, "No, there's more." On the south side of her home, in what used to be an attached garage, there was a horse stable that the original owner of the property had made. It had three stalls, a wooden floor, with sliding doors in front and in back. The back doors were always open, as that is where they kept their lawnmower. She said that around 1 a.m., it sounded like an elephant was stomping around in the stable, to the point that it shook the whole house. Her husband armed himself and went out into the stable, but he saw nothing, and nothing was out of place. I told her that her story was indeed creepy, and I asked her what she thought she had encountered. She said she had no idea, but it must have been either the predator from the movie or a Bigfoot. I asked her what made her think Bigfoot. She explained that she had read once that they are sometimes seen as though they are cloaked. Now, her story immediately brought to mind an incident that we had here on our farm back in 1997, and it was eerily similar. One Saturday morning, my oldest son, who took care of our horses in the morning, came in and told me someone was in our barn. I asked him if he saw someone, and he replied that he had heard them up in the barn loft. Now, this is when I was still a deputy, so I grabbed my duty belt, roused out the whole family to go out to the barn with me. I posted my wife and our two sons where they could observe the north, south, and east sides of the barn. I went to the west side, where the middle door of the three doors was directly across from the stairs to the loft. I wasn't really convinced that anyone was in the barn, so nonchalantly leaning on the half door, I ordered anyone upstairs to come down now before I filled their backsides full of lead. As soon as I said those words, it sounded like what I have always described as an elephant ran across the barn loft and slammed into the south wall. It made the entire barn shake. With my duty weapon in one hand, I took my portable radio and contacted county dispatch. I requested an officer to assist me in searching for a trespasser in my barn. Presently, two deputies showed up, and I explained the situation, and I said no one had exited the barn. Together, we searched the entire barn, and we found nothing. For a couple of weeks afterwards, I was the object of a lot of jokes for calling for backup for a ghost hunt. Well, whatever it was, it shook a barn that is so solid that we could drive a tractor and a full hay wagon up into the loft. It sounded so much like my neighbor's experience. Here I have included a photo of that barn. Was either incident Sasquatch related? I have no idea, but they are certainly creepy. And these images, the tree break images, were taken this past weekend. The pine tree, which was not dead or rotten, was broken off about 3 feet above the ground. Nothing had fallen on it, and the needles were still soft to the touch. This was in the same area of the Hoosier National Forest where we had found tracks, and a structure that I have sent you images of previously. This is the second tree break that we have found there. Signed, Steve. Now, all of those were pictures that Steve had sent in. I find them fascinating. I love when people do include neat photos like that. Give us a little bit of an idea of the surroundings and what took place. You know, it's hard to see looking at that barn how anything could have left and not be seen by someone on the outside. Now, as I've mentioned, Steve is retired law enforcement, and he has sent in other encounters before. If you want to hear them, or if you would like to just listen to them again, I'll have the links to them in the video description below. Now, also, while you're down there poking around in the video description, you're going to find a link to the Teespring store. So go ahead and use that if you've been hankering for a mug or a sticker. And if you're in need of some good smelling stuff, use that code for BB10 and get 10% off your order from Yeti Bar Soaps. You'll find that code and the link to their website in the video description too. All right, otherwise, I think that's going to bring us to the end of this evening's stories. Thank you for hanging out with me all the way to the end. And until we meet up again, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening.